increase. The internet has provided more than 700 online retailers in my home state of Montana to sell their products across the nation, creating jobs in their communities. You know, before I came to Congress, and I just served 2 years in Congress before being elected to the Senate here this fall, I spent 20 years in the private sector. In fact, I spent 12 years as part of an internet startup company. We started out as a couple hundred employees and grew that to 1,100 employees and capitalized at $1.8 billion per an acquisition. But I tell you that because I think the internet is one of the last laboratories of economic freedom that we have left in this country that is really unhindered by regulation and by taxes. Some say this isn't a tax increase. Well, if it looks like a tax increase, if it sounds like a tax increase, and it harms small businesses like a tax increase, then it's probably a tax increase. It's interesting to see just this morning in Japan, and I did business in Asia for many years, the Prime Minister, Shinzo Abe, announced this morning with the news that the Japanese economy now is back in recession. What are the first two things that he announced this morning in Japan? Number one, they're delaying a sales tax increase in Japan. That was his first action he took. The second, he called on special elections. And by the way, the Tokyo market rebounded on the news, the Prime Minister announcing the delay in this sales tax increase. With Cyber Monday coming up on December 1, it's a reminder this legislation will hit and harm economic activity and growth, and importantly, consumers' pocketbooks. That is why our hashtag here is no net tax. It's a threat to small businesses, a threat to jobs. Colleen Rast of Kalispell, Montana, she started selling products online. It was a hobby 13 years ago. Today, she runs a small online retailer with 4 employees. And she said the cost of complying with these added burdens would prevent growth and possibility of hiring more workers and even threaten the status of current employees. And so we're asking is that this legislation be dealt with in regular order. I'm encouraged that Speaker Boehner has said that Marketplace Fairness Act won't be taken up in this lame duck session. But Harry Reid has said he'll do whatever it takes to get that done. Well, I'm here for folks like Colleen in Montana. Big corporations have a voice here in Washington, but someone needs to look out for small businesses. Anything that takes money from small businesses or consumers and puts it into the pocket of government should be dealt with in regular order. It should not be a deal done behind closed doors, like what they're proposing here, attached as a rider to must-pass legislation. So I'm appealing for other members to sign on to a letter urging leadership to stand firm against any efforts to include an internet sales tax as a rider on any legislation. With that, I'd like to introduce to you Senator Ted Cruz.
Thank you, Steve. Appreciate Representative Daines for organizing this. I'm very pleased to address him as Senator-elect Daines. We are looking forward to welcoming him and many more new colleagues into the Senate come January. The internet has been a haven for freedom and for entrepreneurial activity. You know, for most of the history of the country, if someone wanted to start a business, it took significant capital. You had to get startup capital to create a bricks and mortar business. You had to get a distribution network. You had to get wholesalers. You had to get the ability to get your products to your customers. The internet has enabled unbelievable entrepreneurial opportunities. It has enabled people who are struggling, young people, Hispanics, African Americans, single moms, to start a business, and with a website and a PayPal account and FedEx, you have a nationwide distribution center instantaneously. Right now today, the Obama economy is struggling and is gasping. We have the lowest labor force participation since 1978. Millions of Americans are hurting. And the internet is one of the bright spots. The last thing we should be doing is passing a massive new internet sales tax. We just had a wave election in which Republicans retook the Senate. Harry Reid was retired as majority leader, and the American people said, we're unhappy with the direction we're on. It would be the height of lunacy if one of the first things the Republican majority in the House did was join with Harry Reid in passing a $340 billion tax increase online retailers. One of the important things to understand about this, this is a tax that is a favorite of K Street. It is a favorite of powerful and favored corporate lobbyists. And it is singularly directed against the little guys. Part of the reason why this bill has momentum in this town is because it's a perfect storm of big box retailers, large bricks and mortar retailers, combining with the large internet retailers, the overwhelming majority of whom have physical presences in states across the country. So they're already collecting sales tax as well. So you've got all the big guys coming together to Congress saying, wouldn't it be great if you took every little startup and forced them to collect taxes for 9,600 sales tax jurisdictions across this country? Imagine for a second, if you're a single mom, you've created a new product, you're starting a business, you want to support your kids, and suddenly you're expected to know the tax rates of every state, the tax rates of every county, the tax rates of every local jurisdiction, the tax rates of the Albany School Board, and whether it changed from 4.5% to 4.75%. You're required to keep paperwork for all 9,600 of those jurisdictions and collect those sales taxes, even though you have zero impact at the ballot box. If you don't like those sales tax, you're not allowed to vote on those. That is a burden that is directed to the little guy. And we ought to stand together. We ought to protect the internet. You know, in Texas, we're fond of the phrase, don't mess with Texas. I would suggest something that ought to receive bipartisan agreement is the very simple principle, don't mess with the internet. Don't mess with the freedom on the internet that allows people with nothing to start a mom-and-pop retailer online and advance towards the American dream. There is a reason the hashtag no net tax has exploded online. Because if Washington comes in with $340 billion in taxes, it will destroy innovation, it will destroy opportunity, and it will be fundamentally unfair. And I'm proud to stand in this diverse gathering as we stand and fight for the little guys against Washington making it harder and harder to achieve the American.
Thank you, Senator Cruz. You're going to hear some polling data today as well, shows the overwhelming opposition to the American people. And interestingly enough, the younger the demographic, the greater the opposition. This is something that young people, they see it. They don't want, as Senator said, don't mess with the internet. Now I'd like to invite Representative Thomas Massie.
Well, I want to thank Senator-elect Daines for his leadership on this subject. When we got here as freshman members in Congress, I decided somebody needed to go to the floor and speak against this internet sales tax, and Congressman Daines was eager to join me, and I think it was a wise choice. He's elected a senator, and I just want to say that there's a misnomer applied to this legislation. It's been called the Marketplace Fairness Act. Whenever you see the word fair, you need to grab your wallet, because it's not going to be fair. I suggest it should be called the Offshore our Online Retailers Act, or the Interstate Commerce Sales Tax Act, or just the Internet Sales Tax. But, you know, the United States is a country of innovation. If you want to get ahead of your competitors, I suggest you don't come to Congress and ask us to punish your competitors. I suggest you invent something new. You treat your customers better than the other guy, or you come up with a better way of manufacturing your products. But the right answer to get ahead of your competitors is not to come here and call it the Marketplace Fairness Act and ask us to punish your competitors. That is not the American way. That is not what's caused this country to prosper. Finally, I want to say that some have said this is about states' rights. This is about empowering the states and giving them the rights to pass these taxes. This bill does nothing to protect states' rights. This is not about states' rights. In fact, this bill changes the very fabric of the United States. As the Supreme Court said, established many years ago, it's a physical presence that is required before you are subject to the laws and regulations and taxes of that jurisdiction. Folks, this goes back 200 years. Our country was founded on this principle, no taxation without representation. So the internet sales tax would go against the principles that this country has been founded on, and that's a good reason to oppose it. Thank you very much.
Good morning, Phil Bond. I'm the executive director of the We Are Here Coalition, a coalition of 13,000 small online retailers. I want to just make three brief points. One is to underscore the unfairness of the Fairness Act that Mr. Massie was just talking about. It puts a bigger and different burden on online retailers than it does on brick and mortar retailers. And then it sets 50 state tax collectors loose on the internet to go audit those companies who have no presence, who live or work in those states. That's why it is unfair, as Mr. Massie said, and it is taxation with representation. Point two, I want to underscore the low margin of online retailers, on average 2 to 5%. So when proponents make so much of the $1 million threshold, understand that on average, that's a $30,000 margin. That's why Etsy opposes this for very micro businesses, because one or two employees and you're over the threshold. That's why public opinion is so strong against it too. Gallup found 57-39 against. When you go to voters under 50, it's 62% opposed, and voters under 30, 73%. This is not an issue for the future. And as I underscore the margin, I want to underscore another point Mr. Massie made, which is ultimately this is a bill that would empower Goliath to slay thousands of Davids, not good public policy. And finally, I want to thank Mr. Daines for his efforts to encourage Speaker Boehner and leadership to stand strong, support the committee process here in the House, where Bob Goodlatte has done such good work in identifying principles that people can rally around to legislate. Marketplace Fairness Act, as written, is unfair. It is lame legislation rammed through the Senate under a lame process. It should not be considered by a lame duck session of Congress. That would be totally lame.
That was a lame comment. Thank you.
I'm Walter Jones. I represent the 3rd District of Eastern North Carolina in the United States House. And I have been here 20 years and will be elected for another term. And I think Senator Cruz, or certainly someone before me, said that this is a prime example of the group trying to push the little out of business. I have been here, and I mentioned that length of time, because too many times I've seen policy decisions being made because of money. And the policy decisions that are made because of money are not fair to the average citizen. The internet world, as been said before me, is a world of freedom where little and big can operate together with mutual respect. But if we allow this internet sales tax to become a reality, it will destroy the hopes and dreams of so many people who themselves cannot compete in the big world of Washington, D.C. So I join my friends from the private sector and the elected officials who are here today in saying to Mr. Reed, please, Mr. Reed, even though you will become the minority leader of the Senate, listen to the people of America, the people who have hopes and dreams because they don't have the federal government working to put them out of business. So thank you so much, Senator-elect Daines, for asking me to make a few comments, but I want to join you and everyone else in saying that the lame duck session is not the time to have a tax issue coming before Congress. So thank you very much for allowing me to be a small part of this news conference.
I am Jim Gilmore. I'm the former governor of the state of Virginia. I propose that we have a new initiative in the United States Congress starting now to grow the United States economy. An allusion was made to the fact that the economy isn't doing well, people aren't doing well, and this is true. The reports to the contrary are exaggerated. It's time now to begin to wake up to the fact that Congress has to move to grow the economy. Now, we have new majorities in the House and the Senate, and everybody's saying, well, can the new majority get together on a program? Whether they can all agree? Can the Democrats actually join in some bipartisan way to move the country forward? These are the unanswered questions that are before us. I propose that an initiative to grow this economy right now can be a unifying factor in the majority and can be something that the minority can join with and take to the president to grow this economy. Now, Now, as governor of Virginia, I was approached by the United States Congress in 1999 and asked to chair the National Commission on the Internet and Sales Tax Issues. This very issue, Senator-elect, was what we'd spent a year working through. That commission was an official commission of the Congress. It was sponsored by the Congress. It contained three governors on that commission. It contained the mayor of Dallas, who is now the trade representative on that commission. Representatives from major business like AT&T and Gateway and AOL, in order to have a genuine input to offer a proposal and a policy for the United States. And that commission reported in 1999 that sales taxes should not be imposed on people doing business on the internet. Now, all these years later, that there's nothing that's changed that makes that policy any different. Small business people are having a chance to grow and flourish, as was suggested here. They're having a chance to do that. These companies are going to have to, as was alluded to, going to have to collect from 9,600 jurisdictions. That means that the small guy or gal who are trying to start a business and be entrepreneurial are at a disadvantage under this potential legislation. I had a laugh about the allusion that the senator-elect made to Japan. We ought to recognize that whether or not business and opportunity and growth and jobs succeed in this country is very sensitive to tax legislation by this Congress. The Japanese example is precisely right. They just imposed sales taxes over there up to 10%, and then they went into recession, and they're all very puzzled. How come they went into recession? Well, it's obvious, isn't it? Because they were adding 10% onto every consumer in Japan who wanted to buy anything, and therefore consumer purchasing went down. Is it not rational? And they figured it out yesterday, and as a result, they're changing their policy right now, but we in America are now being asked to do the same type of thing. I suggest to you that the policy of the United States must be now to do everything that we can to eliminate bad policy and to enact good policy. And make no mistake about it, over the last several years, we have made action after action that is anti-growth. The ability to write off investment has been extended and therefore reduced the ability to write it off. Taxes on investment have gone up in this country. Dodd-Frank is wrecking the banking community in this country. Obamacare has some good points about it, but look at the bad points about it. They discourage growth of small business. So what are we going to do? Do something here right now, either in the lame duck or into the future Congress, that is going to discourage the growth of small businesses and harm small businesses in this country where the opportunity for real job growth exists in this country. Besides, is it not true that consumers in this country ought to have the liberty to be able to choose their variation and form of commerce without constantly being nicked by the federal government? That, I think, is the policy that we all stand for here today. And thank you, Senator-elect, for the chance to speak to you.
Doug Lamborn, Colorado. I want to thank Senator-elect Steve Daines for the great work that he's done on this issue. I've never supported internet sales tax collection, whether in the Colorado legislature or here in Congress, for many reasons, but one of them is a fairness reason. The Quill decision that the Supreme Court handed down years ago made it clear that if you have a physical presence in the state, then it is appropriate for taxes to be collected to support that physical presence. If you have a brick and mortar operation in a state, then you're gonna need local fire protection, police protection, and those kinds of local services that a sales tax would support. If you're an internet retailer across the country and you have no physical connection to that state, it's not fair to be collecting taxes to support your operation because you have no physical presence in that state. That's what the Quill decision is all about. I support the Supreme Court jurisprudence on this issue, and we shouldn't change horses now in the middle of the street. We should stick with the policy and not have a worse policy that's going to hurt our economy, like unfortunately Harry Reid would do if he persists in what he's having the Senate do. Let's vote against the Harry Reid measure. Let's support freedom and less taxes and Supreme Court jurisprudence. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Laura Sanders from the Art Street Institute. We're a free market think tank located right down the street in Chinatown. We've worked on this issue for a long time, and I'm incredibly grateful to the congressmen and senators here today who have joined with us in saying that the Marketplace Fairness Act is something that is fundamentally unfair for American small businesses and for the American consumer. we've actually commissioned a lot of polling on this issue that I would encourage you to go to our website and check out. But the highlight of it is that in our national poll we conducted, the Emerging Police Fairness Act was unpopular by 57% to 43%. We also commissioned polls in 20 different states that looked at it and really dove down into the issue. And it was unfair. It was considered unfair by all demographics by double point margins. But at the end of the day, the question isn't just is something popular or not popular. We have to think about what good policy is. And just being unpopular doesn't necessarily make something bad policy. But luckily for us here today, the Market Police Fairness Act really is just bad policy. So we've heard a lot about how it's not fair to make businesses collect taxes in places that they aren't located. So to put that sort of in layman's terms, because that's how I think about things, I work just down the street in Chinatown, and I live in the wonderful Freedom State of Virginia. My son is in second grade, which means I inevitably get phone calls just about once a week saying, "Mom, I need a poster board for my project tomorrow. Mom, I forgot to do this. Can you pick this up at the store on the way home for me?" So what do? I walk down the street to the Walgreens, the wonderful three-story Walgreens that we have in Chinatown, and I pick up what he needs. Now, when I go to check out, does the woman at the cash register say, "Are you going to use this in the District of Columbia, ma'am, or are you going to take this home to Virginia?" That doesn't happen to me. I don't know if this ever happened to any of you, but that's what we would be asking online businesses to do, and it's not something that brick-and-mortar businesses do, and that's not fair. We cannot ask small businesses to tax across 9,600 different jurisdictions, because if you believe that some software provided by the federal government is going to get rid of the complexity there, then I think you believe that TurboTax has solved income tax complexity, which I think we all know is not true. So at the end of the day, it's both unpopular and it's incredibly unfair, and it's not something that we should be considering in a lame duck Congress. We should consider it on its own merits, and I am grateful that all of the congressmen and senators here today would vote against it on its merits. And I would encourage everyone else to do the same.
I'm sorry for getting here late. Paul Gosar from Arizona's 4th District. In my previous lifetime, I was a dentist and have an antique store, so I am one of those brick and mortar stores. This is bad policy. Americans are overtaxed. Well, you know, we have rebelled from the days of the Tea Party in Boston Harbor to the internet to sales tax here. Bad policy, no matter how you slice it and dice it. So what we need to do is get back to having tax reform, not additional taxes. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Senator. I'm Senator-elect Mike Needham with Heritage Action for America. I'm here to express our gratitude to Senator-elect Daines and all the members who have fought with him for their hard work and their vigilance. You would struggle to find a greater example of everything wrong with Washington, D.C. than this internet sales tax. People love to say that Washington is broken. Washington is not broken. It is a finely tuned machine aimed at giving favoritism to those that are well connected while denying opportunity to millions of Americans through regulation, taxation, and confusing laws. That's what the internet sales tax is about. As others have mentioned, this would be an easy law for many of the big box retailers to comply with, other large companies to comply with, but it would be a gargantuan burden to many small businesses, and so we're grateful for the leadership. I would also add our voice to those who have talked about this as a generational issue. When the internet sales tax was up last year in the United States Senate, every single Republican senator under the age of 50 voted against the internet sales tax. 12 out of 13 Republican senators under the age of 55 voted against the internet sales tax. This is an idea that is not the future of our country, and we're excited about the leadership that we've seen on stage here today. So thank you all for your leadership.
Hi, my name is Katie McCall. I'm with Americans for Tax Reform, and I head up their tech policy wing, Digital Liberty. Also, I would like to say, Yonabut Madarak Matarim. Thank you for standing against the internet taxes in Hungary. Thank you for what you've done there to show the difference that these taxes stop freedom. These taxes get in the way of freedom. And I have with me a petition today. This is part of it. That you can find on Americans for Tax Reform's website, ATR.org. We have over 50,000 signers. And it shows that no matter where you are in the world, Hungary or the US, Japan, anywhere, taxes like this really do affect our economy. And this is a vote activating issue. So I second everything that has been said here today, everything is very important, and freedom on the internet, the exportation of regulations via sales tax or any other tax, is not something that we should allow to happen. So I would like to present to you this portion of the petition, which is still open, and anyone can sign on, so please do so. Thank you to all of you for your efforts.
Thanks, Katie. Appreciate it. Go ahead, Ms. Gwinnett.
Thank you so much, all of you, for the work you're doing to prevent the single greatest threat to taxpayers that's still capable of passing in this Congress. Pete Sepp with National Taxpayers Union. I'll throw out just one number, $360. That is the average amount for a household that shops online of increased tax burden that they would see if the Marketplace Fairness Act passes. That was a study we recently commissioned from Andrew Chang and Associates, taking a look at internet usage and the impact of MFA. Now, I know there's going to be this question, well, don't they owe it already as use tax? The point is, this is a tax burden that households would have to pay upfront that they are not paying now. $360, it's more than twice as high in certain states like Louisiana. Members of Congress who are not only economically astute but politically astute realize that this is not a burden to foist upon their constituents, something that would be coming especially at a time when holiday shopping is just getting into gear. And this is definitely a new type of tax collection burden for small businesses. Make no mistake, as some of my colleagues have said, the existence of software will not wipe out the compliance problems that small and medium-sized businesses will have. They will have to deal with auditing authorities from 45 other states and perhaps even some local jurisdictions. That is not an idle fear. Ask small and medium business owners, Linda Remishatis, Tom Carlson, Wes Berry. Memorize these names. They've been interviewed for our podcast. They have e-tail businesses. They are saying, any of you out there who have had an income tax audit, think of that experience, multiply it by 100, and you have a sales tax audit. It shuts down your business. That's the kind of problems that MFA presents for small and medium-sized e-tailers. We don't need it. The public doesn't want it. Time to bury this bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Representative-elect Daines and Representative Massie and everybody else for your leadership on this issue. And for organizing this press conference. I'm Norman Singleton, Vice President of Policy and Campaign for Liberty, a grassroots pro-liberty organization founded by former Congressman Dr. Ron Paul. Campaign for Liberty strongly opposes passage of the Marketplace Fairness Act or any other legislation imposing taxes and regulations on the internet. We agree with everything that's been stated here by the previous speakers as to why this is a bad idea. We also think that just like you shouldn't a bartender shouldn't give an alcoholic a new line of credit at his bar. Congress should not give state governors who are drunk on taxes already a new line of taxation revenue that will enable them to forestall having to address their own fiscal crisis. This is not going to help state governments. It's going to enable them to dig their fiscal hole even further by delaying the reforms that they need to enact to get their house in order instead of just looking for to the American people for constantly new sources of revenue. Any politician who votes for the Marketplace Fairness Act, as Senator Cruz mentioned earlier, either as a standalone bill or as part of an omnibus or tied to the internet access moratorium, which is apparently something that is still being discussed in the Senate, is someone who clearly did not get the message the American voters sent Congress 2 weeks ago. Campaign for Liberty members are going to make sure that those who vote for the Marketplace Fairness Act in any form in the future will finally get that message that the American people do not want taxes on the internet.
Great. Well, Well, thank you. And as Wayne Gretzky once said, he skates to where the puck is going. And you have visionaries here who can see beyond the current crisis in Washington and understand the future and economic opportunity is keeping the internet free and tax-free. And I think this really comes down to the issue of global competitiveness as we look at this, these percolating startups. That the big corporations can hire a compliance department, a rounding error oftentimes on the balance sheet. But we look at the small companies right now, these small and medium-sized companies, is a direct hit on their economic opportunity. And that is why we're standing so firm about the unfairness of the Marketplace Fairness Act. And with that, we open up for questions. We've got more institutional knowledge out here than we did the real estate cat. Yes, please.
Yeah. Would you feel differently about it if an internet tax was based on the location of the seller as opposed to the location of the purchaser? That would eliminate the multiple jurisdiction issue that many of you have raised. I know some of you have answered this question from before, but I wanted to ask you.
And you are?
Sean Higgins, I'm with the Washington Examiner.
Origin-based system is certainly came up in the House Judiciary Committee hearings. It's something that is manifestly more easy to deal with for the business because it's based on where they are located rather than where the consumer is located. It removes the difference between the scheme that the Marketplace Fairness Act has, which is harder for online retailers, easier for brick and mortar. So this would be more of actually a level playing field to talk about. However, the question is, I think, more fundamental than that, as some of the speakers have alluded to, which is having to do with the economy and questions of what is good policy at this particular time. However, on your question, I think origin sourcing has far greater support among smaller companies because it's something based on where they live and work.
I just find also the irony of the third largest economy in the world this morning announces they're delaying more sales taxes, and their equity markets rebound in a positive fashion in response to that. So we just believe fundamentally this is not good policy, it's not good economic policy.
I just reiterate, Campaign for Liberty opposes any form of new taxes on the internet. As I said before, state governments and Congress should be finding ways to cut spending and deal with their fiscal irresponsibility instead of finding new ways to squeeze money out of the already overstretched American people.
And I would actually refer you, we testified on this for House Judiciary. You can find on our website, rstreet.org, our Executive Director, Andrew Moylan, testified about origin-based sourcing, so you can find that there.
I'll just make a quick point. This is an issue of nexus, and this is really an issue of states wanting to export their regulations across their own borders. So it's been mentioned before, all of the audits and things that business would have to deal with. These are people who don't have the ability to vote. So you're dealing with nexus, and what states are really after is being able to go after business income activity or to go after your income, the bills, BATSA, Business Activity Tax Simplification Act. There's also the mobile workforce. And then if you look at something like digital goods, these are things that define nexus so that states can't reach across their borders. And that is the biggest problem with the Marketplace Fairness Act, is that it lets states, you end up with, 50 different IRSs coming after you. Those are audits, those are liens, those are any kind of EPA regulations, emission regulations that any of these states can come after you for. This is the beginning of 51 different governments coming after you. So we need to look at nexus, we need to look at what the implications are for any kind of internet sales tax and what precedent that sends.
I think that's a bit of a red herring because that's not what the lobbyists here are asking for. They're asking us to reduce competition among the states. They don't want anybody to be able to escape the taxes. Now, does the state of Kentucky have the right to tax somebody in the state of Kentucky? I believe they do. If our governor, though, came to me and said, do you think I should tax internet retailers in our state in an origin-based system, my recommendation would be don't do it. Because competition, at least competition still exists in that realm, and the states that did enact an internet tax on their originators, where the sales occurred, would see less business. So at least it has that aspect. But it's a red herring. It's not something that anybody I've seen here is seriously pursuing.
I want to throw one more point in there, which is it is illustrative, and I think important to note that the proponents of MS anything other than their scheme, especially origin sourcing. And I think it unmasks their real purpose, which is to wipe out their smaller competition, which is what the MFA is designed to do. Origin-based sourcing would have less impact there, and so they're adamantly opposed to that.
Okay, I think we've expired our time here. Folks will be around here for one-on-one questions, but thank you for being here today. Appreciate it.